This is a very special video. I am in Denmark.
I just saw a man last week and he was just like, I've never heard of this condition ever. And it hit me, but what is it?
It's more and more clear to me that we will probably have to do more than one thing to help these men. And also at a much earlier stage than we've done so far. I think this is hot stuff because once it comes out that we actually admit that calculating the curvature can have a degree difference of 5, 8, maybe 10 or 12 degrees. How can you say that a treatment of 8 degrees improvement is actually an improvement?
I was thinking about you saying that some patients improved and some didn't. And this brings me to one question I've had on my mind for the last couple of years. Do you think, are there any different variants of this disease? Is it one name for different diseases? Because I see so many, I have many men in my practice, and sometimes you don't feel a thing. Penis has a deviation. Sometimes you feel something, you don't see anything on ultrasound. Sometimes they go to bed with a straight penis. Next day they wake up with a deviant penis. Sometimes you have the plaques right away. Sometimes you have, you can feel the plaques, like you can move them around. They're just tiny and there's no hardness whatsoever. It's just a plaque. And sometimes it's like it's a big something in there that seems to go through the whole entire penis. Do you have the same experiences?
Yeah. I think that's why some of the non-operational treatment that we tried doesn't give us 100% or 60 or 70 or whatever in treatment improvements. I think they respond differently. They have different types. If we ever get to know what subtypes they have, I don't know. But definitely, there is a huge difference in the type of the scar tissue. As you say, some are really hard, like a stone or a bone, and others are more soft. So, depending on whether there are calcifications is also an important issue, I think.
I think calcifications is the line that I draw. So there's a huge difference in outcomes, and you see it even in the literature between calcification and non-calcifications. But they behave differently. So I've done a lot with shockwave therapy and tried lots of treatment protocols and was looking what happened. So if you look at the literature, shockwaves are not recommended. So they say it doesn't help. It helps with pain, that's for sure, but it doesn't help with curvature. And I kind of agree with that, but not really, because we don't really know what shockwaves really do and in what way they can help. And if we would have several subtypes, then we would have a confounder, because we would have to pick those who respond to shockwaves. And in my experience, those who don't have calcified plaques, who have a palpable mass in the penis, when I treat them with shockwaves, this mass disappears within half an hour. So after the treatment, the penis is totally soft. And this stays for 3 to 4 days. Then the penis is hard again. But during these days, it is soft. I don't know what this signifies, but in my thinking, like if I would put on traction in this phase, so I soften them up, I put traction on them, maybe this is a way to apply multiple treatments to have a better outcome.
Yeah, definitely. I think the same. And I also tell the patients, if they ask, well, most of them, if they just did a little bit of research, they've read about shock waves and say, do you think it works? Well, the literature says that it only works for pain in the beginning. But I think some of the reasons why we haven't shown an effect yet is that there are different subtypes and some men respond more to shock waves than others. And maybe we use it too late. And when you compare the studies in the literature, they have different machines, different settings. They don't use the same frequency and all that. So it's very hard to compare the shockwave studies with each other. So until we agree on a setting, or we have more studies with the same settings to compare and larger trials, because, I mean, you've probably seen them too. I've seen men who definitely had effect, statistically significant, from shockwave. And if it wasn't shockwave, what was it then? I mean, we know there is a spontaneous, but that's in the acute of maximum 10%. But
one that gets from 70 to 30. That's not just
coincidence. This is why we need doctors like you who do these research studies and gather these patients together, because I think one of the problems in Peyronie's disease is that nobody does extensive research. So there's, in relation to how frequently we see this disease, there's too little research. Everything's on cancer, but this is a big problem too. I tell my patients, if you look at the guidelines and see what has been tried, there are pages and pages and pages of treatments that have been tried and nothing has worked. So I think we really need some more research. So I understand that you are ready with your research now and you're not performing this anymore here at the hospital.
Correct.
What are your plans for the future?
I haven't decided yet whether I will continue with injections, but if I would, I would definitely combine it with very systematically penile exercises. For instance, penile traction or shock waves or vacuum erection device. And I also like to do it sooner. Though I have a heart for the chronic part because I don't think we can leave them behind. But I'd like to look at both faces of the Peyronie's disease. So, yeah.
There's one question I forgot to ask you. When you were injecting the stem cells, how would you attack the plaque? Because the newest method is like going, inserting one place and then going like in a half circle, then just tunneling the plaque.
I did tunneling. Well, I injected in the skin and then I found the hard parts. And even though it was very hard to push anything in, I would still tunnel it from various directions, as many sites as I could, and then try to inject it. Also, that the more tunneling, I imagine that the stem cells would better enter to the hard parts.
Did you see any side effects, by the way?
There was no major adverse events, but there were from the liposuctions. They had sore abdomen, ecchymosis, and paresthesias. In the penile, they had just a bruising, a sore. There was no large ones. I think they were very suspected.
I'm always very careful about the neurovascular structures because many plaques are on the dorsal side.
Yeah.
Did you see any adverse effects there?
No. Because they're always under. So if you have the fingers and you inject directly into the plaque, you are in a good distance of the neurovascular bundle.
Most of the viewers of UroChannel, they're from the States. And you have been to the States just a few days ago. So when did you come back?
Oh, it's a month ago.
A month ago.
True.
So you spent half a year?
We were there 3 months. Yeah, I visited the lab.
At UCLA?
Yeah, I did. And they're doing a lot of research as well. They did earlier on Peyronie's disease. Right now the focus was, the studies that I was assigned to were more about erectile dysfunction in rats and different ways how to help them.
And you did this for your PhD studies?
I did it not as the personal part of my PhD, but more as an expanding my knowledge and seeing how research is done in another place. And I know that this lab is particularly, they've made huge amounts of research in Peyronie's disease, so I was very interested to go there.
How would the viewers come into contact with you?
Well, I am in the Danish medical society, so I'm in the public hospital system. So it's only Danish citizens who can get my
medical help.
But during my PhD, the news has spread around. I put up on clinicaltrials.com and a lot of patients actually read those. So I've had emails from all over the world during my 3-4 years doing the studies. And I answer in the best way I can, but I can't give any medical advice really or help them from a distance.
So I have to apply here to the hospital and they have to be from the Danish healthcare system.
Yeah, they have. So, even though people were, I can move to Denmark, I can learn Danish,
I can adapt Danish standards. Can I just enter in the trial? So sorry.
Yeah. It tells you about just how desperate the men are. Yes. No, it's exactly sad. Or they feel there's no help.
Well, moving to Denmark, I can tell you from my own experience that it's very difficult to talk Danish to people here because they always switch to English. And my wife, she always laughs because I tell people, no, we are in Denmark. You have to talk Danish to me. Dr. Majken, I'm very glad that you agreed to do this interview. I think it was very interesting and I learned a lot. And I wish you all the best for the future and for your PhD. And I'm sure you'll be brilliant in the exam.
Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity. Thank you.
Thanks.